is our executive producer, and Sonya, as you know, in her scenes, sexy lady.
Getting down with the B team now. Yeah.
Sonya, with so many twists and turns in the show that I've noticed over the season, is there one that surprised you?
Yeah, you haven't seen it yet. That one was part of my mind, too.
But you knew that was coming. We planned that a while back.
You told me season one. I mean, you told me beginning of season two. I didn't know that was happening.
I guess that was the beginning of season two.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
So you now have integral to Alice and work with her, and from season one, there was that whole thing between everything with Ben and not wanting to, and maybe you won't be able to tell us, but is there something along the lines later on where you'll come back and then change the relationship you have with her now, like working with her, like is something going to happen later on, or is that something that's just going to keep going?
I can speak to it as far as you've seen. I think what's really fun is that Alice and Margot discover perhaps more in common than they thought. And there's a sort of begrudging mutual respect while still there's a lot of wariness because Margot is Margot. So you want to be careful of that. But I think, you know, that was one of the things, those beautiful therapy scenes that Allan wrote us in season one, what I think was so lovely there was the sort of, Margot had this moment of realizing they were both betrayed by the same thing, and then they actually have all this common ground. And so that sort of moves into season two, where I think they sort of realize they're both strong, empowered, intelligent women who can go toe to toe, and neither one's going to stand down. And when they realize neither one is going to stand down, then they have to kind of work together. I love the relationship. I also just love doing scenes with Marae, so it was fun.
Right here in the back.
I have to know, how long did it take y'all to film the umbrella scene?
Yeah.
I mean, that was John Stewart Scott, our fantastic director, who done some episodes on season one and does several more on season two. One of the things we all love about John is he comes with such a great band, and he arrives so prepared. And to do a scene like that with so much coverage, meaning you've got big wide shots and close-ups, and you know, you've got so many different angles that you want to have, not just to tell the story, but then to tell the story in an exciting way, that you want to have someone who comes in really mapped out what the day is going to look like. And John is impeccable like that, really wonderful. And we are blessed with an amazingly efficient crew. That said, it took forever.
Amazing.
But he was great.
And you have to get it on before it gets dark.
Stupid o'clock.
So where does the title The Cat come from? I think when I first started watching this show, I thought it was, you know, because Alice is trying to catch Ben, but then I don't remember if it was the end of season one or the beginning of season two where there's a line where he says, so what's the catch?
Yeah.
So where does it come from?
Well, for me, the show, before I came on board, a version of the show already existed, and it was, I think, a reference to Alice catching Ben. That was her drive. But for me, it was about love. Like, you can't have it all. Like, there's always going to be a catch. The guy you fall in love with who turns out to be your soulmate is also the guy who stole all of your money and is a career criminal. So, like, in love, it's never the whole fantasy. It's always, there's always something pulling you back down to earth, as much as we want to be fully, you know, I think a lot of us look at love as an escape from our daily lives, and the catch is that what real love is something less romantic and a lot harder to achieve. And so that's the way we've been proceeding, is like there's always a catch with these relationships and how do you work it through? How do you work through it?
I love all the banter.
Oh, I'm so glad.
I really know.
I'm so glad. We have the most amazing cast, so it's so fun to write that for them.
You came in and basically redid the pilot episode for a third time now from the previous two that have been done.
I was the second time.
You did? Oh,
yeah.
The second time.
They shot a pilot, and it was about, Alice was a forensic accountant, and everybody played different characters. Sonya was not in it. Pete Krause was not in it.
There was a lot of recasts.
And then those two roles were recast. And you guys had shot maybe a camera test or something, right?
Not even
that. And
oh, yes, a camera test, sorry. You're right.
But that was all the footage that had been shot. So they were just about to shoot Pete and Sonya into that existing script, but the network couldn't figure out what the show, based on the scripts that came after, they couldn't figure out what the show was. And so that's when I was brought in to say, if you reimagined it, what would it be? And how much would it cost us?
Well, because I see a lot of familiar other shows and the relationships that are in there. Did you take inspiration from certain other popular shows that...
Well, I have been on Scandal when I got this job, and then Grey's Anatomy before Scandal. So I've been in Shondaland for about 10 years, and I had a real sense of what I would want to see if I were watching Thursday nights. And I knew that if murder, like murder's pretty dark for me, so I knew I wanted a sort of lighter, more fun, sexy, fashion forward. I worked on Sex and the City. I sort of missed that. I miss smart people talking smartly to each other, wearing amazing clothes, and talking about real love issues, like how relationships really work. So, and that's sort of my thing anyway. So, yes, we referenced the Thomas Crown Affair in the pilot. We referenced an Ernst Lubitsch movie called Trouble in Paradise in episodes 2, 3, and 4 with, I don't know if you remember, the princess who comes in and Ben befriends her. That's all a steal from Trouble in Paradise, which is one of the best movies ever made. Get a chance to see it. And throughout, I'm a pop culture junkie, so I try to put as many Easter eggs as possible. But like, I was a huge Happy Endings fan, and so Zach Knighton came on at the end of last season, and we try to, John Sim came on because I'm a huge fan of John Sim. So pulling in as much of that stuff as possible is fun. No Lost references yet. But
no, not yet.
Yeah. I'm now getting a book. Hired lady who's like, hi, we don't do black on this show, so you're in a theory pantsuits. That's usually what wardrobe is like. But you go in with Peggy and this chick a rack of the most exquisite dresses.
You guys met Peggy last year.
Yeah.
She's wonderful and has just the best eye. And I think this is the fun of doing season two of a show is, you know, she now knows my body better than I do. So the dresses are not ones that I would pay. I'm a mother of two. I'm lucky to get dressed in the morning. So be zipped into a thing with heels and the hair. And it's glorious. It's glorious. And it just means also, by the time I've been through the works, Margot's there. Like, it's such an enormous part of being a character, is having the right look and you know, jewelry and hair and makeup and things. It really, really is. It's like zipping on the suit.
I have to say, the show is crazy. It's just crazy. In a great way, but it makes it really fun wardrobe-wise. Like tonight you're going to, you haven't seen it yet, but you're going to a fake underground casino, or the Barbra Streisand outfit that you wear to the bank. With the wig, she walks in as Barbra Streisand, and I'm like, can we get away with it? Is it too much with the glasses? No, it's not too much. It's fine.
Nope.
So, it's really, I mean, I've never, well, Sex and the City was a bit like this too, where we just kept pushing and pushing. But Peggy has such a clear sense of the actor and the character that it just is a delight. Like, I've never, one time, Gina Torres wears a terrible coat. Six or seven, but it's supposed to be terrible. But I was like, this may be too. You'll see it. It's, you'll see it. But that was the one time in two seasons where I was like, does it really have to be on television? Otherwise, perfect.
Do we get a lot of energy?
Every episode. She's in every episode. Yeah. She's fantastic. And she can wear clothes.
There's so many strong female leads. Are the guys starting to feel a little outnumbered there? Or are we going to get some more?
I think when we brought Reese on full time, Pete Krause was like, all right, I'm okay now. I've got my partner. He feels a little bit better. And now they're sort of a comedy trio with Gina joining them this year. So I think this year that sort of went away. But in the beginning, I think for Jay and for Pete, there may have been a little like, there's a lot of ladies. I'm not sure that our on Grey's quite a bit too. Like,
totally fine with that. Just don't care.
I'm like, you don't understand. You're a fantasy. You don't get a point. But it is a duet. The show, I mean, really, it's an ensemble. But he and Murray really. The show, it's interesting because I think the biggest change that I made was to give his character a point of view. If you'd seen the original pilot, you're in her head the entire time. You have no idea what he's thinking or why he's doing what he's doing. So the big change was Act Two of that original pilot is all from Pete's point of view. So you fall in love with him. You understand that he's in love with her. Like, it really is a duet in that sense. So, but we do have a lot of really strong women.
Great.
What a great message.
How are the characters evolving through the episodes? Are they changing a little bit from what you originally pictured?
I think they are. I mean, what's interesting on this show is that the heroes and villains are so sort of clearly drawn at the front of it, right? He's a bad guy who took all of her money. She's someone who was victimized because she fell in love. And then it shifts so quickly so that even someone like Margot Bishop, who kills people for a living, by her own admission, becomes someone you actually feel for and root for. And that was sort of the beauty of, like, I when Sonya and I met, like, I got the job, and then I met with all the actors one by one, and I said, congratulations. You have a new showrunner and a new character to play. I hope you like it. And so everybody was great. She was especially great because she got it immediately and pitched me in that first lunch, and I've said this in the press previously, she said, what if the way that Alice and Margot finally meet is that Margot is pretending to be Alice's therapist? And I was like, I don't know how to do that right now, but that is the best idea I've ever heard. And so I came back to the writer's room with that idea, and they were all really eager for it to be in, like, episode 2 or episode 3. And I was like, no. You keep, like, and I, well, the point I was going to make is, I said to Sonya at that lunch, your character's completely different. We talked a lot about the relationship between Judi Dench and, why is his name? Yes, and Daniel Craig's James Bond, and that initially, you know, I was really writing for Pete and for Sonya, and the previous version, they were sort of being put into something that had already existed. And this was me as a fan saying, like, I want you with your most British, like, smartest, most British, most, like, crafty, she's got the big vision for everything. But Margot's role is interesting because she's barely in the pilot. She's got, like, four scenes. Two scenes. You just have to trust me on this. This becomes your story. Your family becomes, like, a huge part of what this is. The benefactor is going to be either your mother or your brother, and trust me, it will develop. And I don't know if you believed me, but you pretended to believe me. Sure enough, like, by episode 2, 3, 4, you just start to see it shift and grow so that it really in some ways becomes as much Margot's show as anybody's show. Like, by the time Reese shows up and then Sybil shows up, for me everything changed when Reese showed up, because they had a scene, a brother-sister scene, where they were on the bed together, and it's one of my favorite scenes we've ever done. And I just wrote a big 4-page dialogue scene just because I had John in my head, and that's when the show changed for me, and I was like, oh, this is now. So it does, you really have no idea when you start the degree to which it can grow and change, and it has everything to do with your cast, because if they weren't capable of it, I wouldn't be able to write to it. So, and it's a very collaborative environment, and I'm constantly bouncing ideas off of them and saying, and even in rehearsal, like, what's working, what's not working, call me, come to me, if you have a great idea, let's do it.
But that is exceptional. That really, really is. There is, I can count on no hands the number of showrunners that are that transparent and accessible. And hey, what are your feelings? You know, most of the time, and understandably, because the train has to run on time and you've got to keep things moving, but most of the time you get the script and that is
saved. You don't have time.
So it's a rare, great thing to work with someone like that. Which, to answer your question again, is part of why the characters do evolve and
change is because there's so much back and forth. There's room to that you're not dealing with someone who's just writing what they need to write. There's actually room to see what you're doing well and then write to that.
And I knew we had to reinvent the show completely in this second season. I knew that part of what I think turned people off in the beginning, and this was partly our fault, we only had one episode to show people by the time we aired. And so I think everybody thought we were doing The Fugitive, where it's like, I don't want to watch her chase him for 10 episodes. That makes me tired. I don't want that. So there wasn't time to do, like, now we have 10 episodes in the can, and we're able to show you, like, this season. I don't know if you guys have seen this new teaser that they just put out for the whole season, but this season is a huge romp, but that's what last season was too. We just weren't able to communicate that to people or to the press in a way that told people what the show is more clearly. So I knew, okay, season two, we gotta spin everything around, and if we are lucky enough to get a season three, we're gonna do it again. Like, it's gonna be a completely, same characters you love, but new dynamics, because I think what happens in TV, and you know this as longtime TV watchers, you get into the same character cycles. Like, even on Grey's, mm-hmm. part of the reason that I ended up leaving after season six was, like, I could not write another Christina Owens scene. I just couldn't do it. I felt it paralyzing me, and I felt like we were repeating ourselves a lot, and that's one of the things that we work really hard at on The Catch, is, like, always spinning the dynamic a little bit, and what two characters have ever had a scene together.
Right.
Let's try to figure out how to do that, and that's how the season started. This season was, I really wanted more Margot and Alice. Like, what happens when Margot walks into ADI for the first time? I want to watch that show. And then Margot ends up hiring the person she was trying to kill 72 hours ago.
Right.
So yeah, we're lucky in that we get to reinvent the show every 10 episodes. Which is
can we bring back Mom?
Oh, yes.
I fell in love with her from the first episode she came into, and I need more.
Yeah, you're gonna get more. She's fantastic.
She's great.
I love her so much. She's the best person, too. And she lives in Studio City. Valley. But as a huge, that's another perk of the job, is, like, as a Downton Abbey fan, I found out that she was in town and available, and this was while we were shooting the pilot, and I called ABC and I said, can I get clearance on Leslie Nichol, because I think she needs to be Sonya's mom. And, you know, we didn't end up using her until 9 episodes later, but, like, that was just because she's in town and she's available. She's a lovely woman. So, yeah.
Do one last question right back here.